Good evening. Thank you for coming out tonight. May God bless you in this time together. Pray that you will come with us and be drawn into the heart of God. Let me have a prayer with you, shall we? Gracious God, thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you for bringing us to this special point in time where all things change. And the reality of your plan for us comes full manifestation as we begin to see the passion and the hope and the life that is ours. Meet us now, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stand if you're able, and let us sing our opening hymn, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. Responsive call to worship. Come and gather in the upper room, in the fellowship of the disciples, in the presence of our Lord. Take part in the costly meal which is prepared for you and me. Let us eat the bread broken and torn for us. Let us drink the cup of promise, bitter yet sweet. Stay and pray in the garden on the eve of his betrayal. Wait. Keep watch and pray. Worthy is the Lamb whose life is offered up for ours. Worthy is the Lamb to receive our worship and our praise. Amen.
Like an ocean of sorrow is under my skin. Even the current will carry me. You are my strength. You are my song. You in our hearts. Send us your light as we're making our way through the dark. All of our earlier troubles, chaos and pain, they unravel. Looking ahead, we rejoice.
You may be seated. Join me now in prayer. Gracious God, before you, everyone bows. Every knee, every voice, every king, every pauper, everyone will bow before you. In this day of preparation for the coming of Easter, we bow to you to acknowledge that we have no standing before you. We've all failed. We've broken trust. We've wounded others for our own self. We have denied you in word and in deed. We are unworthy to be called your children, and yet, as a Father of grace, you reach out to us. You see our wanderings. You know our failings, and you reach out to us, and you say, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden with sin, and I will give you rest. And so we come, God, tonight to make our confession before you. These things are heavy on us, and in silence now we lay them before you. Hear our silent prayers of confession. Gracious God, receive these confessions with the heart of one who loves his children. We offer ourselves to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news that as far as the east is from the west, so far God has removed our sin from us. So hallelujah. In his name, we are forgiven. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated while we have our response.
Lord, I come. confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Well, a special welcome to those who are following us online today, couldn't be here tonight. We're glad that you are here. A special outreach, shout out to Lynette McGee, who tonight is recovering from COVID. Oh, you just thought these guys were cool singing a cappella, right? Special thank you to our music team. Thank you so much for what you bring and how you bring it and your flexibility to do that. God is blessed and we are blessed. Thank you. Thank you. So open your hearts with me as we enter into God's word. Gracious God, Your word is true. Your word is sure. But your word pierces us in many different ways, and we pray that tonight you who have been preparing our hearts will speak to those hearts. You who have seen all we are will speak to all that we are. Come, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. There aren't many passages in the Gospels, certainly not in Mark, that actually portray Jesus and his disciples as eating. Have you ever noticed that? Jesus sleeps, Jesus cries, but does he eat? And in fact, the text we're going to look at tonight is probably the only one that I can think of, that I can find, where we actually have Jesus and his disciples eating together. And that's appropriate, because this is a very special meal. It's a meal that's been memorialized in the Christian faith. It's known as the Last Supper or the Lord's Supper, but there's more going on here than a supper, than a meal. This is a meal that will invite us, will define us, and will satisfy us. Can you think of special meals in your life? Can you think of a time, maybe there's a banquet in your honor, maybe it was at a special family, something that you remember so well that you'd like to do that over and over and over again because the food was so good, right? Or maybe it was the importance of the gathering, or it was just the flavors that you got in the meal, or maybe it was the company of the people who shared it with you. More than just the talk that we have around the table, it's often food that conveys a lasting memory, telling us how important this was. Maybe it's an old family recipe that was prepared and it connected you with days gone by. Or maybe it was a seasonal dish that's only prepared at a certain time of the year. Do you have particular food like that? Food that you associate with Easter coming up. Or maybe there's food that is just Christmas or Thanksgiving or some other special time. My mother-in-law used to make a special dish. It was mashed rutabagas for Thanksgiving. And it's not that anyone actually asked her to make them, but it connected her to her family, to the people she grew up with, to a time gone by. And so she made it to connect us with those powerful voices of the past. Our passage tonight has those kind of elements in it. This is an old family recipe. This is unique food just for this event. This is important people gathered to eat and to recall a very special time in their family life together. It's a meal that was painstakingly coordinated for just this time so that those there would never forget the deep, deep meaning. Let's join them at the table with Jesus in Mark chapter 14, beginning at verse 12. Hear the word of God. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house he enters, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened. And one by one, they said to him, "Surely not I." "It is one of the 12," he replied, "one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him, but woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he'd not been born." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. May God open our hearts and our minds to his word. So let me confess to you, I am not a great cook. I can do a pretty good burnt offering on the barbecue. And I can follow a recipe fairly well, but man, that's my limit. Now, the interesting thing is all our children have developed to be, have pretty good skills in the kitchen, even to the point of going off the recipe, adding a few things to new elements, to experiment, to make a new dish. And I think about that, and part of it is they take after their mom. They are good planners. You gotta be a good planner if you're gonna cook. And that's what's happening in this text. It's the first thing that stood out to me. Jesus had a plan. And Jesus is playing kind of the role of party coordinator here to put together a dinner, to direct the course of the meal, to meet his purpose. The meal invites us to be with Jesus. Now, did you notice how much forethought Jesus put into the location of the meal? How much detail that went into finding the room? They said, "Where do you want to have Passover, Jesus?" And he didn't go, "I don't know. See if you can find some place. Look on Craigslist, something." No, it's more like a spy novel, wasn't it? He said, "Look for a man carrying a water jar." Now, men don't usually carry water jars. So look at a man for a man carrying a water jar somewhere in Jerusalem. Follow him, go into that, ask the owner of the house he goes into, and you know, there are probably 2 million people in Jerusalem during Passover. So trying to find a man with a water jug? Not an easy task. Residents, though, were expected to open up any extra rooms they had for all the strangers in town so they could have a place to celebrate Passover. Now, if you're doing a special meal for someone, you're going to have to do some serious thinking, some serious strategizing, some serious planning. And half of our passage this evening is given to his followers finding what Jesus called my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples. Jesus has it planned. He clearly had thought this out and perhaps even prearranged it beforehand. At the very least, we know he had the power to know who to talk to and where to ask for the place for the meal. And it was all very intentional. No one was there by accident. When we come to this table tonight, we need to remember Jesus did this for us. He was planning for you and for me. His invitation is not an accident in our lives. He knows you. He wants you to be with him. Have you ever been a VIP somewhere? You are tonight. You are a very important person to Christ. And each dish that he's prepared for you, he prepared with you in mind. Now, in the Passover meal itself, it's made up of distinctive dishes, you might know, that put them all together, and they actually tell the story of Exodus from slavery in Egypt on. And the first part of the meal, actually, the youngest person at the meal will stand and say, "Tell us what is special. Why do we celebrate this night as a special night?" And then the head of the family would stand up and he would recount the Exodus story. And so this meal represents pieces of the Exodus story. It's the theological ingredients to it. Unleavened bread reminded them of how they had to leave Egypt in haste. They didn't have time to put yeast in the bread to let it rise, so they had to cook it and go. And The bitter herbs and the greens and the stewed fruit all reminded them of the struggle there was in those 40 years in the wilderness. And of course, the lamb, the blood of the lamb marked their houses so that the angel of death would fly over them and not take their firstborn child. The lamb was crucial. And so this meal reminded them who they were and what God had done for them and how God felt for them. They were God's VIPs, and this meal said it. The food celebrated and then consumed reinforced their identity. They belong to God, and God reminds us of that. Now Jesus shifts the lesson of the table from the past to what God is doing now in the present, and even to what God would do in the future. For you and I are now invited to be part of this meal, for this meal will define us. First time I met my then girlfriend's parents, I was invited to dinner at their house. Now, my mother had trained me well, so I had pretty good manners. I was not going to make a fool of myself at that dinner. But Carol's mom didn't care about my good manners at all. In fact, she wanted to get past them. And so she cooked a meal of discovery, I'll call it. Cracked crab. And so here we are. We each have a nutcracker and some warm butter and a pick to get the meat out of the leg or out of whatever. And there we go. And it was great. It was a mess. We were all messy. We were all messy, and it's okay. That's who we are. And I think that's what Jesus leads us into next. His words challenge the facades, the faces, the hiding places of the disciples. His words go deep to make them so uncomfortable they start to think, what have I done? Could I be the one that he's talking about? None of it could be easy to hear or even easy to say, but Jesus said, I tell you the truth. In other words, listen up. This is important. One of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. Now, there were certainly more followers in that room than just the 12. It would be customary for women and children, those who were traveling with Jesus, to all be there as well around the table of the feast. So there are an awful lot of suspects in the room. And don't you think the room just went silent? That all those conversations came to sort of an awkward end? The text says they were saddened. They were shocked. They were dismayed. Everyone wondered if somehow it was them. And instead of rejecting the accusation, say, oh, it couldn't possibly be me. One by one, they went to Jesus, kind of like going through the metal detector at the airport, just waiting for the buzzer to hit because you forgot to take something out of your pockets. Just waiting for Jesus to say, surely not I, is it? Yeah, it's you. You see, every one of us somehow knows we failed God. Whether we are a devotee, a fervent believer, or not, we all wonder, what did I do wrong? Have I failed to follow well enough? Did I not learn the lessons that were being taught? Or is it something I'm going to do, something that will be accidental, something that will be unintentional? Jesus' words remind us the truth that we already know. God knows who we are, and we've all failed. We're messy. We've all sinned before him. We've all betrayed his love. But then Jesus said, no, it's not you guys. It's someone closer than that. They've been sharing food together. In fact, he said it's one of the 12, smaller group, one who dips bread into the bowl with me. Think about that. Next time you go for a burger and fries and you're going to share that communal pot of ketchup, who do you let dip in your pot with you? Not a whole lot of people. It's got to be somebody really close to you. This person was close to Jesus. But Jesus, interestingly, doesn't share who it was. We don't get to hear what went on between Judas and Jesus. It was private. It was a one-on-one confession. And Jesus didn't plead for him to stop. He didn't threaten him, ask him to reconsider, or sick his other 11 disciples on him to say, knock it off. He warned him. In fact, everybody in the room was warned. It's not going to go well for you when you decide to go against God. How does that go for us? How's it going in our lives? All Lent, we've been practicing self-examination, looking inward, trying to look at, evaluate our attitudes and our behaviors, trying to remove or reorient those parts of our lives that betray our identity as disciples of Jesus. What have you found in your life that needed reordering? Jesus knows that already. So instead of letting that define you, Jesus offers you the same offer I believe he's making to Judas here and every other disciple in the room: to be defined by grace and forgiveness, not hatred, not greed, not spite. Tonight, when we share this meal with each other, before we do that, we're going to have an opportunity to consider, what is it in me that Jesus doesn't want to just pass over, but rather he wants to redeem? Private, one-on-one time, you and the Lord. God's love invites us and wants to define us. Will we let him? You know, the meal, the Passover meal, was divided into four sections. That beginning section with the questions and the answers. But each one would end with drinking a cup of wine. But something had changed as this meal goes on. Jesus is offering a new course. Jesus is offering a variation on the salvation liturgy of the Passover. The new meal is meant to satisfy us forever. A description of the Passover meal in F.F. Bruce's commentary on Mark says, at the head of the household, in this case, Jesus, would lift a platter of unleavened bread and say, this is the bread of affliction, which our fathers ate in the land of Egypt. Let everyone who hungers come and eat. Let everyone who is needy come and eat the Passover meal. And then taking the loaf of bread and blessing God for the gift of the bread, Jesus would say, praise be thou, O Lord, sovereign of the world, who causes bread to come forth from the earth. And then he would take that bread and he would break off a piece for everyone at the table, and it would be passed all around the table till everyone has a piece. And they would all eat it in silence. But Jesus adds another ingredient here. Take, this is my body. Now, he's not offering his physical body. Instead, he's offering his person, his being, who he is, to be consumed. He's offering himself to his disciples and to us so that he would form us into a new body, to become a new community that takes its identity from the presence of Jesus within each of us. Thus, the fractures within the body of Christ are not of his design. Instead, our unity finds its rootage in Jesus as the center of who we are. We are his new creation, and he will be with us forever. His body satisfies the deepest hunger we have. So tonight, when we eat the bread, we're celebrating that in Christ, we're no longer loners. We're not outsiders. We're not just individuals. We belong. We're bigger than a denomination. We're greater than any theological distinction. We are one in Christ. But are we? Is that how we function? Again, We'll take time to consider before the meal, what are we letting divide us from others who claim Jesus? What are we adding to the flavor of Christ from our own preferences, our own spice cabinet, and distorting Jesus? Is it Jesus and America? Is it Jesus and miracles? Is it Jesus and tradition? With the offer of his body, Jesus becomes manna, like God sent to Israel. They needed nothing else to eat. Manna. He is all we need to consume. So what else are we snacking on? What's taking away our appetite for Jesus? Where else are we trying to find satisfaction? Let the body of Christ be enough. And finally, at the end of the Passover meal, Jesus took that third cup of wine and prayed a prayer of thanksgiving. May the all-merciful one make us worthy of the days of the Messiah and of the life of the world to come. And ironically, that prayer was answered and standing right before everybody. The cup of hope was transformed into a cup of belonging, a cup of covenant, a promise that was sealed with Jesus' blood, not sprinkled over the people as was the common event of the Day of Atonement, but consumed by the people, internalized by all of us. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. In Hebrew thought, blood is where the life of a being was. So when we drink his cup, we have his life in us. Our salvation and forever relationship with God is locked in. It's sealed with his blood. This price that he paid for our sin was his life, and it changes us from betrayer to beloved, from loner to brother or sister, from forsaken to found, from salvation long ago to new life right now, right here. Drink deeply from it. What a meal. I get full just talking about it. We are invited to something that's familiar, but it has a new flavor. We've been defined not by something shocking, but by one who forgave us, knowing full well who we are. We are satisfied as a part of his body, filled with his life. And there's no room for anything more. As we come to the table tonight, remember, you are a VIP. This meal, this rich and expensive meal, was prepared for you, given out of love. Will you take it? Will you eat and drink all of it? Let's pray. Gracious God, again, your provision is far beyond our imagination. You have given us good things, and we say thank you. Lord, I pray that our hunger would be satiated with you, that Jesus will be more than a thought, but a reality in our lives, that as we eat the bread and we drink the cup, you will meet us now. And Lord, in this time right now, before we come to the table, we ask you again, what is it that we are consuming that takes away our appetite for Jesus? What is it, God, that we're allowing to divide us, to make us bitter, to make us upset? Who is it, God, who we don't want to invite to your house, to your meal, to your life? Lord, speak to our hearts tonight and grant us grace and forgiveness. Hear us now as we pray silently. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so the meal is before us. It's provided for us. And you are invited. On your journey with Christ, you are invited. Whether you know him well or you don't know if Christ is his last name, you don't know what it means to be Presbyterian or anything else, but you just know you're hungry for something, something more, and he will meet you. That night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread of the table. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that's broken for each one of you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same fashion, after supper, Jesus took the cup from the table. And he said, "This cup is now a new covenant poured out in my blood. Drink you all from it. For often as we eat the bread and we drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." And hallelujah, he comes. So friends, let me invite you to take out your personal piece of communion tonight. If you don't have one, if you just raise your hand, we'll be sure that we get you one. Has everybody got one? And I'd invite you to tear off the cover off where it has a cross, it should have a cross on it. So that's the bread. This is the body of Christ broken for each one of you, broken that you might be whole. Do this in remembrance of him. And now remove the other. This is the blood of Christ that is poured out for you, for your life. Do this in remembrance of him. And now, Lord, guide us to be your people in all things, in all ways. In Jesus' name, amen.
Table of the King. so with thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth, as we share in his suffering, we proclaim Christ will come again and will join in the feast of heaven around the table King.
Thank you. Join me in our closing reading. When Christ came as high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made. That is to say, not part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more, then, will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciousness and acts lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. Amen. Will you stand and sing with me when I survey the wondrous cross?
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain
Before our benediction, let me remind you, tomorrow night, Good Friday, we have a service here at 7 o'clock, Tenebrae service of darkness, and then Easter Sunday, 9 o'clock, the uplift service, and 11 o'clock, our celebration service, all happening right here in the sanctuary. We look forward to seeing you, and bring a friend. It'll be a grand, glorious proclamation of the good news. Now, join me in our benediction. You will. You can grab a hand or lift your hands, however you're so inclined. There you go. Now go in peace and bless the world. And remember, you go nowhere by accident. Where you are going, God is sending you. And where you are, He has placed you. God has a purpose for your life right where you are. Christ Jesus, who indwells you, has something that He wants to do in and through your life right where you are. Believe this and go in His love and in His grace and in His power. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Yeah.